All right, so for this second part, we're going to be talking about equivalence tests, which is another way of looking at a null model or a null effect, looking more at equivalence. So what if you wanted to actually stay within a frequentist framework? There's no need, or with equivalence testing, there's no need to actually leave Bayesian statistics, and you can stick within a frequentist framework when it comes to doing this. Now, within this framework, it's not possible to support a hypothesis that an effect is exactly zero, but you can actually reject effects which are large enough to be considered worthwhile. So going back to that Facebook example that I used before, if we would assume that an effect of, say, 0.1 is worthwhile when it comes to behavior intervention, that study undoubtedly would still be considered statistically equivalent because the effect size was so small, because we don't actually consider an effect size of 0.01 to be worthwhile, but maybe we would consider an effect size of 0.1 to be worthwhile. Now, in order to do this, you need to specify what this worthwhile effect is, the upper bound and lower bound of this effect for equivalence. So when you're combining equivalence tests with traditional null hypothesis significance testing, there are four possible outcomes when you do this. The first outcome is that your effect is statistically equivalent, but not different. So here it's important to see that the thick lines represent a confidence interval of 90%, because what you're doing here is you're actually performing two one-sided tests. And if it's a one-sided test, that's why you're going for that 90% confidence interval. And the thinner line up here represents your traditional 95% confidence interval. Of course, you can adjust what your confidence interval is going to be, but this is going by the typical 0.05 threshold. So you have these four potential outcomes, that they're statistically equivalent and not different. So here, we've set our equivalence bounds as that should be 0.5, point minus 0.5, and 0.5. So here, for argument's sake, we're assuming that effects that are larger than 0.5 are not really meaningful. So our equivalence bounds are 0.5. Because the two thick lines have fallen between these two equivalence bounds, then we can say that these effects are statistically equivalent. So they're not different because it crosses zero, which is kind of your traditional way of understanding p-values, but they're also statistically equivalent. For our B outcome, we have an effect which is actually statistically different. As well as being statistically different, it is not equivalent. For effect C, you have an effect which is statistically equivalent and statistically different. So in some cases, it's rare, but in some cases, this is actually possible. This is probably the same sort of thing you'd get with that Facebook study. It's statistically different, but it's not equivalent. Outcome D is that it's not equivalent or it's not different either. This tends to happen when you have smaller sample sizes. So you have these four potential outcomes. But how do you set your bounds? This is a difficult question. One way of looking at it is, what is a just noticeable effect? Now, depending on your research question, this can change, and we'll go into this soon. You can also look at Cohen's small, medium, large effect thresholds, but as we learned before, these are just rules of thumb, so maybe not the best option. But when you ask people what a just noticeable effect is, often you'll get a shrug, I don't know. But when you ask people, how many people can you collect, they can tell you straight away. They can go, we have enough resources to collect 100 people. So one way of looking at this is, what do you have sufficient power to detect? In an ideal world, you would theoretically think, okay, an effect of 0.1 is just noticeable or just interesting. But quite often we're limited by our resources. So a better question to ask is, okay, with the resources that we have, what do we have sufficient power to detect? But regardless, you should pre-specify and justify your choice. Okay, so in order to do this, you can also do equivalence testing power analysis. The power analysis that you would typically do for detecting an effect is slightly different for equivalence testing. For equivalence testing, you need slightly more participants that you would need. So say if you wanted to detect an effect size of 0.2 using traditional power analysis, if you're doing it using equivalence testing, you have to have a few more participants. You can calculate power using an Excel spreadsheet, which is available with the introduction companion paper. And you can also do power analysis using the TOSTER R package as well, where you can run your equivalence testing, but you can also do power analysis. So let's have a look at equivalence tests in action. And in order to do that, we're going to open up Jamovi. And if you haven't already, install the TOSTER module.